cha 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 cha
excited to be in the house of the Lord. Then show your appreciation to Jesus. I don't know if you are still alive in this place. I can't tell how excited you are, but this is something that beat my imagination. And that beat my understanding, prophet, that you will see a letter filled with air and 22 adults chasing after that small ball, and you can have about 35 people who are doctors, lawyers, dignified people, taking off their shirt and screaming and shouting because a letter is moving on a field. But I can't tell how believers take this. When the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords come in an assembly like this, and you can celebrate and rejoice, then I have a problem with you. Then I have a problem with you. Then I have a problem with you. I want to see people who are crazy for the name of Jesus. I want to see people who are mad for the name of the Lord. For the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous, they run into it. They run into it. And they have a problem. I have money. I have a problem. Whereas we can express our excitement to the Lord. If the president walks in here, everybody will stand up. Everybody will clap. Just a human being. But what about the Lord of Lords? The King of Glory. The mighty one, the I am that I am, the unchangeable changer, the Lord that rules and reigns. He is worthy this morning to receive all glory and to receive all honor. Child of God, lift your voice and
Amen. Celebrate your maker. Celebrate your Jesus. Celebrate the Holy Spirit. Celebrate the Father. For he alone is worthy to receive all the glory.
Listen, I'll show you. Take your handkerchief, your victorious handkerchief. Thank God people have green handkerchief, but this house we have white handkerchiefs. You didn't hear me. White is the symbol of purity, is the symbol of holiness. So they said Joseph was so loved that the father made him coat of many colors. What was the father saying to Joseph? I make you a presentation that everywhere you turn, there is something that speaks over your destiny. Because the color green is the color of growth. The color gold is the color of riches. The color purple is the color of royalty. The color white is the color of purity. The color red is the speaking of the blood of Jesus over you. But this morning, we know and we know without doubt that as for us, we are more than. Lift your victorious handkerchief and let me teach you the Ghana style. Oh, look at the victory banner. Look at this victorious banner that have been lifted in Bulawayo. Look at the celebration in this house. Hey! Listen to me. When I say Yesu Christo, Yesu Christo, oh say yeah, then you shout yeah, yeah. Then when I say Yesu, then you shout yeah, Yesu, oh say aye. So you listen to me first. When I say Yesu Christo, oh say je, then you respond, je, aye. So we'll take that one first. Then you wave your handkerchief. Yesu Christo, oh say je, je, aye. Hey, Yesu Christo, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the mighty warrior, Jose, 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 Jose. Hey, can you wave your handkerchief one more time? Lift your handkerchief, wave it, wave it, wave it, wave it. Somebody give me a dance.
Everybody blow your trumpet. blow, blow your trumpet. Everybody blow your trumpet. Ba 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 ba. Everybody blow your trumpet. Everybody give God a dance. I will dance and praise you. Oh, I will dance. Everybody give God a dance. I will dance and praise you. I will dance. Everybody give God a dance. I will dance and praise. Dance, 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 dance. Everybody praise the Lord. I will praise Jehovah. Praise Jehovah. Everybody blow your trumpet. Ba 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 ba. Everybody blow your trumpet.
Jesus a shout! Give Jesus a shout!
Huh? I feel like the conference continues for another week. God is too much in this place. There is nowhere to be but to be in the house of the Lord. But the other day, the Bible says that when Jesus took three of his disciples and went to the Mount of Transfiguration, when they saw the presence of God, they said, let us build our tent here and never go back again. You will not miss out in this era. I said, you will not miss out in this era. Give Jesus a shout. Hallelujah. I bless God for the servant of the Lord, the prophet of this house, the prophet of the nation, the prophet of this city. Without him having a vision of this, I wouldn't have met you, you wouldn't have met me. So I want to say, church, help me appreciate this great servant of the Lord with a shout of praise. Let's celebrate the gift of the house. Somebody do it. Are you jealous of him? Are you jealous of him? Are you jealous of the gift? Celebrate Jesus. Hallelujah. Those of you who did not come with anything to honor him, it's an error. And I want you to say, the honoring have just begun. It continues to 31st. So if you don't have your portion, make sure before 31st of this month, you have honored the servant of the Lord. Recently, the Lord taught me a lesson. He said that they eat out of the pulpit, but they don't feed the pulpit. So they get the pulpit so drained, and yesterday they want to be full. There is no way you can be full when the pulpit is drained out. The pulpit must always be fed. The pulpit must always be fed. And how can you feed the pulpit? Is by honoring the pulpit with your sacrifice. In fact, anyone that stands here with a message. So I don't do this, prophet. When there is funeral, I don't announce it from the pulpit. I step out or come somewhere. Because anything that stands here, whether it's a bed that is here,
when he stands here, there is something different that is coming. And you must learn how to feed the pulpit. Give to the servant of the Lord. Let the servant of the Lord feel that the people really appreciate the sacrifice I am sacrificing for them. It's a danger for you to cause him to be annoyed, hungry, to come to stand here and speak to you. It is never a blessing. So church, let's appreciate one more time the servant of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And we have a mother, the mother of Zion. And I tell you, this morning, she lose caucastic, frontal, brutal, nature-shocking, but words cannot explain. Let's appreciate her. Pastor Mrs. Fury. Somebody do it better for Jesus. Hallelujah. And I want to honor all the pastors who have been ordained and all those who have been called into the ministry and those who are already in the ministry. I want you to help me appreciate every one of them. Oh, do it for the man of God. But you know my saying, and never forget this, that anytime you come here, you must know you are the most important person in this house. Therefore, celebrate your life. Hallelujah. Before I continue, I want to do this first. We're going to take our offerings, our tithe, and those of you who pledge with your seed, I want you to come and drop them on the altar. Don't mess it up. Those businessmen who are sowing seeds for their businesses, I want you to drop it here. Then after this, I'm going to take another seed and I will tell you what to do. Hear me, it's an error for you to squeeze money. When your hand is like this, and somebody wants to give to you, come, pastor. Pastor, don't you know you are now a pastor? I said, give your money to me. No. And my hand is like this. Can I receive that money? So a lot of you are telling money, we don't want to receive you because you have squeezed money. And hear me, money is the spirit. Bible says it has wings, it flies. But money goes to the place where it is being celebrated. So if you are giving to the Lord, you don't squeeze the money. You don't let the money feel sorry that you are giving. You must keep releasing the money because you know that God is about to cause men to give to you. And some of you have a habit that anytime you come to church, you have to get your $1. And no matter what the preaching or whether the angels stand in front of you face to face, whether or not, my $1. Stop the habit. Because you're telling yourself the only blessing I can receive is money. And me, I am not afraid of money. I am not. If God asks me to give, I give. Today, let your giving be different. Some of you have taken your $1, but you have a son. All the money on you is $26, 26 checkings. The money in your pocket now is $26, 26. I want you to check it. But you have taken $1 already. You have taken $1 already.
testimony right now. Are they hearing me? Are you hearing me? I said the money on you is $26. Check it. It's $26. Are you that one? I saw you do your hands. Have you checked it? I want you to release the 20 out of the 6 and keep the 6 to yourself. Are you ready with your tithe, your offerings? Lift it above your head and say, I send you forth to go and call your bigger brothers. You don't know. If you are giving $100, the bigger brothers are multiples of the 100. If you are giving $20, the bigger brothers are the 100. Showed me a mystery of prayer. So I used the acronyms of prayer to write this book. The Lord said to me, P in prayer means press. And he says that the olive is nice, but when you don't press it, the oil in it will not come forth. And he says, when you want to know the character of a man, press the person. If you want to know anybody, you put pressure on them, and they would come out with their true colors to you. So the P in prayer means press. For as soon as Zion travailed, she brought forth. If you don't press, you will not deliver.
So if a woman is at labor, they say push, press the baby out. And some of you have been pregnant for too long. It's about time you press. And the Lord said to me, R in prayer means release. 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 The A in prayer means all, not some of it. All. 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 For you have all in all. This is not where you experience a breakthrough today and tomorrow you are suffering. Where you experience an open door today and no. It should be all continuously. The why in prayer means your. It is for you. It is not for anybody. It is for you. It is for you. The E means excellent. All that is for you is excellent. All that is for you is for excellent. The R means reward. Reward. So to me, prayer means press, release all your excellent reward. When you press, there is no way you will not release all your excellent reward. But some of you have been too full and you are not pressed. And the Lord said, pray these scriptures with them. And I want to obey. Exodus chapter 3, the verse number 21. That's the number one prayer we're going to do. Can I give it to them? Let them read it together. Exodus chapter 3, verse number 21. For these people shall never go empty. I said, you cannot end this year empty. Then he is not a God that spoke to us. Because he said he will give these people favor. He will give us favor. That when we go, we will not go empty. I prophesy to you that you are not ending 2012 empty. Even if it is just a minute, your miracle will surely locate you. Somebody shout and say, I receive it. And I will give these people. Oh, shout it like a student of the word. I will give these people. He says, I will give you what? In the sight of your enemies, God will pour favor upon you. And it shall come to pass that when you go, you shall not go. Now lift up your right hand. When God says, I give, you say, I receive. I told you yesterday, when I'm giving you something, you either reject it or you receive it. But God said, I will give these people favor. So you are going to shout. Shout and say, now I receive that favor. Never to be empty in this year. And in many years to come, I will never be empty. Because of the favor I have received. In the name of Jesus. Now place your right hand on your head and call for that favor. Let that favor come. We receive the fullness of it. We are partakers. We are inheritors. We are walking in this favor. We are walking in this favor. We are walking. We are walking. We are manifesting this favor. We can never be empty. We can never be empty.
because of God's favor, because of God's favor, the favor of the Lord is upon us. We are the carriers of favor. We are the carriers of favor. Our heads is carrying the favor. We are carrying favor. We are carrying favor. We are carrying favor. In Jesus' mighty name we are prayed. And let us say shout and louder, amen.
Now you're about to deal with your enemy right now. The prophet says, sit with your families. It's very strategic and important. If you have your family with you, hold hands together. And give me Psalm 109. Psalm 109. Psalm 109. Hold your family together. There are certain things that will happen before the year ends. There are certain things that will happen before the year ends in your life, in your family. Some issues are going to die. You will not enter 2013 fighting the old battles. The verse number 5. Hold your family. And they have rewarded me evil for good, and hated and hatred for my life. 6. Said, can we read it together? Said thou. Are you here with me, John? Said thou over and let Satan. Your voice and say, my father, according to your word, so shall it be against every wicked man that have been set against my family. Let Satan stand at their right hand and battle them in the name of Jesus. Child of God, lift your voice and begin to pray. Let Satan stand at their right hand. Let Satan fight with their own camp. Set confusion in the camp of the enemy. Set a wicked man. Set a wicked man that have risen against my life, that have risen against my family, that have risen against my call, that have risen against my ministry. Set a wicked man over them. Let Satan stand at their right hand. Let Satan resist and fight with his own enemy, because our weapon, they are not carnal, they are mighty through God to the pulling down of every struggle. Wickedness, you will not overcome us. Wickedness, you will not swallow me. Wickedness, you will not fight me. I set a wicked man over wickedness. Let Satan rise up against them. I employ their wickedness as a battle us against them. I employ their master Satan to fight them according to the word of the Lord. So shall it be in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Shout amen. Give me number 7 and number 8. When he shall be judged, let him be. Let him be. And let his prayer become. To teach you one thing, anytime a man of God is speaking on the altar, that he speaks to your direction, take some money and come and sow into it and say, I take this for my life. I did not start traveling until prophecies came and I sowed into it. I took my passport when I was a student went to the field, stepped on it, and I called countries into it. Meanwhile, there wasn't any country I knew of, but I was calling it. I was calling. Ray, you saw my passport. You saw it. You saw the visas in it. It did not come because I desired, because I claimed it. And I claimed it some years back, not now. I claimed it and God caused it to happen. It says, let them, when they are judged, let them be condemned. Do you know why? The excitement of this is that Bible says, enter into his gate with thanksgiving, into his court. What do we do at the court? We check people at the courtyard. So if you have a case, you carry it to the court. But your God is saying, because I sit at the church over the case, you come just rejoicing. Because there is no case at the court of the Lord that the children of God will never win. Therefore, every court issue that has been sentenced against anyone in this atmosphere, let it be canceled. Let it be canceled. Let it be canceled. The judge will not condemn you. The church will not condemn you. Every court issue, today we judge it to your favor. We judge it to your favor. You will not lose it, because your God have acquitted and discharged you. And say, let their prayer become sin. There are some people who are laughing with you, but they are against you. There are some in this church. In fact, somebody is standing just by you. But when you turn your back and you see the kind of knife he have knifed you with, words and actions, you can't believe it. So the Bible says, when they pray, let it turn to sin against them. Say, my Father, let judgment prevail over my life. Condemn now. Condemn now. In the name of Jesus. And when they pray, turn it for sin. Lift your voice and begin to pray, child of God. Lift your voice. Something is happening. Don't be surprised when you step out of this auditorium and you see somebody, you greet the person, the person. Don't be surprised when you get home and the person who stays with you sees you and you say, haven't you seen me? Don't be surprised. Don't be. Don't be. Some of you, tomorrow you get to your job place. The people that flow with you very well, if you hear me, the people that flow with you very well, you get them, they give you cold shoulders and begin to laugh. Begin when you see that laugh, and I will instruct you and tell you, cut off some friends. Cut them off. They are not in your favor. They are not in your interest. So cut them off, because you don't need them. So cut them off. Don't try to make them happy. Don't try to please them. They offend you and you keep making them happy. Let them go their way. Am I communicating? Let his children be father and his wife a... Let his children continually, let his children be continually, and let them seek their bread also out of. This is not my word. This is the word of the Lord. Some of you are taking care of vagabond children. The mother is against you, the father is against you, and you are busy. I'm about to preach and hear the preaching of the word. It will do you good. Lift up your right hand.
Say, my father, according to your word, so shall it be to every enemy of my soul, and to their children, and to their generation. Let them be continuous vagabonds. Let them seek their bread in desolate places. In the name of Jesus, give Jesus a shout.
You have won the battle. Tell your neighbor you have won the battle. Give your neighbor a high five and say you've won the battle. Come with me to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah 54, the verse number 10. There is no way you pray the word of God and the word of God will not act. It's an error. Isaiah 54, the verse number 10. Then I will tell you the scripture that God gave to me to prophesy to you with. After the worship, you know, I took my Bible from you. And the Lord said, look at something. And behold, I looked. And he said, tell my people that this is my mind for them. So I'm about to read that one after we've prayed this. Okay, can we all read it? 1, 2, 3, go. Okay, there are three things God said he's going to do. One, my kindness will never depart from you. You are not shouting a bigger amen. Neither will his covenant of peace be removed from you. And he says, every mountain that surrounds you shall surely be departed. I want you to get home and pick this scripture. Meditate on it. Feed on it. And look at every mountain that surrounds you. If the mountain of barrenness, the mountain of failure, the mountain of loneliness, the mountain of depression, see it scattered around you. Then you will begin to enjoy the peace of God, because God have covenanted to give you peace. He says, my peace I give unto you. But there are two kinds of peace God showed me. He says, my peace I leave with you. So that peace that he leave with us, everybody can enjoy it, because that was left for everyone. But he went on to say, my peace I give. That one is to individuals. It is not general giving. It's to those who will say, God, we need this peace, so therefore give it to us. He said, my peace I give unto you, not as the world will give unto you. Therefore, stop looking for peace from the world. Because when they call for peace, it shall be of war. Are you here with me? But God said he have a covenant of peace with you. Take this scripture home. Eat it up. Let it become sweet in your mouth again. And know that the surety of God's word will never fail. Now, this is what God said to me to tell the whole church.
Me bowudin me bomrani mrani sewe.
You know, you have been singing your song. Me too. Today I'm in my country. Let me sing my song because they said this is my home. And when they put you in home, you do everything you want to do.
Mebo wudi mebo mrani mrani. Sani bechi wa ye yo. Mi unia minka ho. Onya mi wa weni. Unsani juma ye wawa. Nadi yaponi ni na chaye. Israhine. Israel konkrohine. Abraham, Isaac, nyame. Jacob, nyame. Usena wufata. Onyami ukama wukumno. Ukama usena wufata. Minyami ukama wukumno. Ufata. Ufata. Ukama. Wukumno. Sing and say, oh, Father, oh, come on, oh, cool, oh, Father, Yamia, come, oh, come on, oh, you deserve a praise. You deserve a praise. The Lamb of God that was slain for me. Oh, you deserve all praise. That is the English version. You deserve a praise. The Lamb of God that was slain for me. Yeah, you deserve, the Lamb that was slain for me. This is what the Lord showed me and said to me. I said, tell my people that this word is a surety over their lives. Jeremiah chapter 8. The Lord took my spirit to the verse number 17 downwards. The verse number 16 rather downwards. Jeremiah, can you put it? Everybody sit down, please. And just soak this in. That days are always dangerous. So get ready for something new. Is it there? Jeremiah, chapter 30, verse number 16. Are we there? Everybody open it. Are we there? If you are there, shout amen. If you are not there, say, God help me. Be sincere, God will help you. Can we all read it? 1, 2, 3, go. Therefore, all they that devour thee shall be, and all thy adversaries, every one of them shall go into, and they that spoil thee shall be, and all that prey upon thee will I give for. You didn't hear it. The verse number 17. For I will restore health unto thee. The Lord said he will restore what? Unto who? You are not saying it like it's yours. The Lord said he will restore health unto who? Me, Yahweh Abuaji. And I will heal thee of thy. Some of you, your heart is bleeding because of the wounds that people have caused you. But the Lord said this year is the year you have ever experienced wounds, because he says he will heal those wounds. Some of you have been betrayed by husbands, by wives, by people you trust. But the Lord said, I will heal those wounds. Say yes, the Lord. because they called thee an outcast, saying, this is Zion, whom no man seeketh after. Thus saith the Lord, behold, I will bring again the captivity of Jacob's tent, and have mercy on his dwelling places, and the city shall be built upon her own height, and the palace shall remain after the manner thereof, and out of them shall proceed and the voice of them that make. Look at somebody and smile to the person and laugh, begin to laugh. And I will, and they shall not be, and they shall not be, for I will also glorify them, and they shall not be. From today, you are not few. But the church is going to grow than ever thought of. Angels will be doing evangelism. People will be doing evangelism. People will just troop to the church. Nobody will go and call them. They will come by themselves. Get ready for multiplication of income. Multiplication of wealth. Get ready for multiplication on every side. Every project you have begun, it will grow and it will flourish. This is not the word of Edward. This is the word of prophecy. You can go back and check and say, God, you sent your servant to say this to me. And he says, she will not be small. People that are looked down upon you in your family. In fact, some of you, when they do family gatherings, they don't call you because you are not important. But I declare over you, without you, no family meeting will be held because you are becoming too important. At your job place, you are becoming too important. In the city of Balawayo, you are becoming too important. You cannot be small again. The definition people use to define you, it have changed. Oh, don't you remember that sister who comes to church that drive that small car? You are not going to drive that small car again. The Lord said, you will not be small. So if you are not small, what are you? Do this. Your coast have just been enlarged. It's only 20 people who are hearing me. Because prophecies are not for all. It's for those who receive. So when prophecies are given, I don't expect everybody to receive. Because those that have ears, let them hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. Some people don't have ears, so they can't hear. But there are two key things. Three. That God said, he will multiply us. We will not be few, and we will not be small. This is the word of the Lord. Let the Lord bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. In fact, I wish I have these books to sell to you. But since I have one copy, it's for the prophet and not for anyone. Forgive me. I will sign it after church.
Father, speak to us by your word. Teach us. Teach us. Teach us. Teach us by your spirit. Causing us not to be small again. Not to be few. But you will multiply us. On every side of life, Jehovah, multiply us. Thank you, Lord, that it is done. Amen. Take your seat. I cannot be collecting money from you always and not teach you about money. I told you one of the grace God have given to me is about money. It's about money. My next book I must do is understanding money. In fact, I went to England and people have already bought copies. Somebody gave me £50. He said, I'm buying one copy already. Meanwhile, the book has not been written. But people are just buying copies. So he put a demand on me to write it. This one, because I'm now at home, I will release some keys that will bless you. There are four things that makes you poor in life. There are four things that makes you poor in life. One of the things is laziness. Laziness. So God said, you sluggard, go to the ant and learn from him. Because the ant knows how to gather against the storms of life. Laziness. You can desire and wish, but because you are lazy, you'll forever be poor. The second one is ignorance. Ignorant. Wild servants are riding on horses. Princes are still walking because they are ignorant about their inheritance. Ignorance will keep you to think that God did not want you to prosper. Ignorant. When God put his will together in the word, there was one will that supersedes all the wills. And that will was, I wish above all things. There are so many wills. He said, be the head, be the never the tail, more than a conqueror. He has a lot of promise, a lot of will. But there is one will that supersedes all the will. And that is, he said, I wish above all things. That is why that wish was confirmed in the Old Testament. Because I told you the Old Testament is a shadow of the original. So when God wanted to bless Abraham, he couldn't find anybody to put the covenant with her. So God swear by himself. There is nobody who can come with the blessing he wants to bring to you. So he looked at it. He said, if I use angels, if I use people, it will be too small of the blessing. They will not understand the quantity, the quantum of the blessing. So he swore by himself. That is why when he came into the New Testament, he must still swear by himself, saying he wished above all things that you prosper. Wish above the color where you live on the planet of the earth. He wish above the kind of job you do. He wish above the kind of marriage you are in. He wish above the educational background you got. He wish above all the things, your family history. He wish above it all. I stood up and I said, every opportunity my father did not enjoy, I will enjoy it for him and make sure I enjoy mine also. And when I said it in church, people got offended because there were some fathers who were not doing well. So they came to me and said, that thing that you have been saying, we think it's not right. I said, it's not right to you, but it's right to me. Because maybe your father have not told you the opportunities he had that he missed it. But me, my father sat me down and said to me, that Yao, when you are growing up, there are certain things you must do before you hit certain age. Don't wait till you are too old, like me, to start doing the things I'm doing.
and he sat me down and taught me the opportunities he had to have his master's degree in Germany, but refused it because he thought traveling wasn't important. And they were so naive about opportunities. But my father said, every opportunity you see in life, make sure you look at it. If it is a good one, make sure you grab it for yourself. So I said, Daddy, what you could not have, I will have it. So I built my first house before I hit the age of 30 something. I won't tell you. Did you hear me? Ignorance will cause you to be poor in life. While servants are riding on horses. And you know something? God showed me a mystery. That we build houses and we buy houses and we ourselves, we don't enjoy it than our servants. Have you noticed it? Your servant is 24/7 in that house. He knows every corner. He relaxes. Where you are not there, he relaxes where he wants to relax. But you spend some few minutes in it and you are out of it. You will begin to enjoy what you have. I've not started the message for the day. This is the dessert. Then we'll go into the message. The third one is inheritance. Some of you were born into poverty. It wasn't a choice. You came to meet it. Bible says the prophet was anointed, but when he died, they were coming to take his two sons as slaves. Why? Because the thing the boys came to inherit was debt. May it never be so with you. Your children will not come to inherit debt. They will come to inherit properties. Hey, I'm looking forward to the day I will lie on my deathbed and tell my first son, my Bank of America saving, there are 20 trillion that I have willed for you. I have deposited in Swiss Bank some gold bars for my second son. And the children I have adopted, this key is your building in South Africa. This one is for you in Nigeria. This one is for you in Spain. This one is for you. You are not here with me. Maybe it's me alone who want it. They are saying the man of God is becoming greedy. For the earth is of the Lord and the fullness thereof. There is no limitation of where I can own properties. Inheritance. But thank be to God that we have a father who is greater than the father that we walk on earth with. And that father break the back of poverty. And I know me, I can never be poor again. Inheritance. Every inheritance you have inherited that is negative. Today we blot it out by the blood of Jesus. You didn't hear me. You didn't hear me. Every negative inheritance. Some of you, your mother suffered diabetic. You are also coming to inherit it. Somebody, you didn't hear me. Some of you, your father suffered that one. You are also coming to inherit. As for you, we blot it out by the blood of Jesus. You will not inherit any negative inheritance. You will not. The fourth one, sit down, that causes you to be poor in life is overspending. You receive a salary of $1,000. Each month, your budget is $3,000. Either you are stealing or you are borrowing to meet up. And especially, ladies, forgive me. If my mouth is too big, forgive me. When you get to their wardrobes, they have things they bought that they have never worn. And for 5 years, the thing is sitting in that wardrobe. Your money is being wasted. There are some shoes they pack from here to there. And when they want to wear something, they get confused. They are all investments that you have made sitting idle. Overspending. eat at restaurants you cannot afford because you have seen your papa going there. So you want to become a big boy in one day. You will bleed through your nose. Overspending. In fact, it's amazing. No matter how you earn, it can sustain you. If you have not watched, no matter what your income is, God sustains it for you if only you are a faithful tither. These four things will cause you to be poor in life, and you must watch it. And today I'm speaking about one of the things that will make you rich in life. One of the things is work. And today I talk on strategic investment. Strategic investment. In life, if you don't become strategic in life, you always lose in life. For you to win in life, you must always be strategic. You should know where the wind is blowing, and you should follow it. Strategic is a best possible plan to give you an advantage over others. Strategic is a purposeful plan to give you an advantage over others. Because if you don't plan, you will plan to fail. So for you to be strategic, you must have a purposeful plan that gives you an advantage over others. What am I saying here? They call for prayer meetings. They pray in the room for 2 hours. For you to be strategic, you come 30 minutes before the prayer time. And you pray 30 minutes. So by the time they close that meeting, you have invested 2.5 hours into your prayer stock. They say we are fasting for 1 week. But you make a cautious effort even to do one week and a half day. You are an advantage position over the one that did 1 week. And for you to succeed and win in life, you must purposefully place your life above others. You must purposefully. Don't be blind. Investment is the continuous putting aside of money or anything that can multiply. The continuous putting aside of money or anything that can multiply. For the measure that you measure is what will be measured back unto you. Whatever you sow is what you will reap. So for me to invest, it should be a continuous. The word is continuous putting aside. Continuous. So you cannot be praying today because there's a conference prayer. And after that, it has ceased in your life. No more prayer. You are not being continuous. You cannot be giving today and tomorrow you say, oh, there is no need to give again. It should be a continuous act. And a lot of us are not able to receive a blessing because we don't continue to do what we must do to increase in life. And I will tell you, everybody here who earns some income in a month, that after you pay tithe, the next thing to do is to tithe to yourself. Hear me. God gave a good revelation. He said to Adam, eat of every tree. But he gave him one tree not to touch. The other one, God did not restrict him, but God prevented him from eating it. Are you here with me? There were 2 trees. One of them was that it was forbidden to eat. But the other one, God himself restricted him not to eat of it. So he said, the tree of good of knowledge and bad, don't eat that one. But the tree of life, God restricted him not to eat of it. What was God showing man? That when you learn to give the tithe to God, which is the tree of knowledge of good and evil, that is the tithe I want. But there is one that I am restricting you not to eat it, but rather you save it for your future. You are not getting me. You save it for your future. So it should be a continuous act. So if every month I can put $20 in bank as my saving, for me to get into riches and to get into wealth, it must be continuous. I don't break it. I rather increase it than to break it. Because I must continuously invest in. I must continuously invest in. So I say, strategic investment is a purposeful plan to multiply your income. A purposeful plan. You don't eat that one. Because the tree of life, God prevented Adam to eat it. So you don't eat that one. Are you done? Hallelujah. So listen to this. Genesis chapter 41, the verse number 14 to 25. Genesis, the book of beginnings. Chapter 41. Are you there? We are reading from the verse number 14 to the verse number 25. Then Pharaoh sent and called Joseph, and they brought him hastily out of the dungeon. And he shaved himself and changed his raiment and came in unto Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, I have dreamed a dream, and there is none that can interpret. And I have heard say of thee that thou can understand a dream to interpret it. And Joseph answered Pharaoh, saying, it is not in me. God shall give Pharaoh an answer of peace. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, in my dream, behold, I stood upon the bank of the river, and behold, there came up of the river seven kine, fattened and well favored, and they fed in the middle. And behold, seven other kine came up after them, poor and very ill favored, and lean flesh, such as I never saw in all the land of Egypt, for badness. And the lean and the ill-favored kind did eat up the first seven fat kind. And when they had eaten them up, it could not be known that they had eaten them, but they were still ill-favored. As at the beginning, so I woke. And I saw in my dream, and behold, 7 years came up in one stack, full and good. And behold, 7 years withered, thin and blustered with the east wind, sprang up after them. And the 10 years devoured the 7 good years. And I told this unto the magicians, but there was none that could declare it to me. And Joseph said unto Pharaoh, the dream of Pharaoh is one. God has shown Pharaoh what he is about to do. God has shown Pharaoh what he is about to do. Shout a louder amen. Bible says that Pharaoh, an outcast, an Egyptian, the man of the world, had a dream, but he could not have the power to interpret his dream. So he looked for a man who have the spirit of God in him. What am I saying here? The world can have a dream, but we as believers should have the understanding and the pathway to bring the manifestation of the dream of the world, because the world will never have the keys of the kingdom, but we have the keys of the kingdom to manifest the glory of our God. When we leave the keys in the hand of the world, we have failed our generation. But let them dream and let us manifest their dreams. So they will talk of their business, but they cannot achieve it. They will talk of big plans, but they cannot implement it. Because when they say it, we are too smart to know the way out, to bring it into manifestation.
Pharaoh had a dream, told the magicians, and they were not able to tell. Thank you. Thank you. They could not tell of the dream. So Joseph said, this dream you have had, God repeated it twice because it is coming to pass. What am I saying here? In every man's life, 7 years is half of your time on earth. It shall be a time that you can work. It shall be a time that you could have plenty. 7 other years will be the time that you cannot work. You'll be weak in your body. But what you do with the time of plenty, the amount of investment, the amount that you put into storehouses will tell how you will live your life in the other 7 years, which shall be scarcity, which shall not be plenteous as it used to be. So now that you are young, my Bible says, remember your creator in the days of your youth, because that day you can pray the hours you want to pray. You can fast the fastest. You can sit up and study the word. You can do a lot. But what God is saying, all that you are doing in the time of your energetic year is against the time that you are weak, the time that you are old. How you spend your life now will tell how you will spend your life that tomorrow. So Joseph said, let us build storehouses.
A lot of believers don't have storehouses. So when we write dry, we are dry. Then we begin to beg. Whilst you are being paid well, you never thought of saving. You are rather eating big, chewing meat, going to places, spending holiday everywhere. Never thought to invest. And this is what Joseph said. He says, in the time of plenty, let us put a faith. It means when you give God 10%, you give yourself 5%. And anybody who is not faithful to tithe will never have a storehouse. There are 4 kinds of giving. One is the alms. The alms giving is driven by compassionate. If you are never compassionate, you will never give alms. The next one is the seed. The seed is driven by faith. If you don't have faith, there is no way you will sow a seed. It takes faith to sow a seed. The next one is first fruit. What do I call first fruit? Your salary was 1,000. You had a raise to 1,005. You are not expecting 500. So that 500 is not yours. It belongs to the Lord. And it is driven by commitment. If you are not committed to God, when you have a raise, you will chop it. You will eat it up. The next one is tithing. Tithing is by obedience. It's driven by obedience. If you don't obey God, a time is coming that God will bless you, that you receive in a month. The income that comes in a month will become like a million. And if now you are not obedient in paying 1,000, a tithe on 1,000, there is no way you can pay on 1 million. Because you look at it and say, I'm giving God too much. And some of us, we say we are paying tithe, but we are not paying tithe. I have a message God gave to me to preach. The release of the financial order. And he says that when Abraham met Melchizedek, he gave him the tithe of all. What is the tithe of all? If you give me a shirt that I did not use my money to buy, you have increased my shirt stock. If my shirt were 6 and you give me 1 now, I now have 7. So I must learn to pay tithe on that shirt I receive as a gift. And next time when I come, I'll teach you on that. Let's take it for another time. So he says, let's store the fifth part in the storehouses against the time of calamity. Child of God, no matter how much you earn, when you pay your tithe to God, pay a tithe into your investment. Pay something for your children. Think about your tomorrow. Don't eat it all. Don't eat it all. No matter how much you have, it will never be sufficient for you. So learn how to be strategic, investing into your destiny. I will not tell you only to give to God and not tell you give to yourself. I've done you a harm. I must let you to understand that when you give to the Lord with your tithe, a fifth. The minimum is a fifth. So if you can give 10% to God, you also give 10% to yourself. Why did God teach us about tithing? He taught us about tithing so that we can also learn how to invest for our lives. He did not institute tithing because he needs money from us. He did that because he wants to teach us how to also invest for our lives. We need to be strategic investing, because there will always be 7 years of plenty and 7 years of famine. What you did with the 7 years of plenty will tell how your life will look like in the 7 years of famine. There are people that were so rich in cities that now when they tell you that this man used to drive the latest car in town, you will pity that man. Because it doesn't show now on the man. There are people that I knew in my township that were powerful, very rich. But you ask yourself, what went wrong in their life? They enjoyed it today and never thought about tomorrow. When Bible says that don't worry about tomorrow, it didn't say don't plan for tomorrow. What he's saying is that don't be so anxious and think, what will tomorrow come to me? No. By saying, plan for tomorrow. Don't you think Jesus, Holy Spirit, and the Father, don't you think they sat down in heaven and thought about the earth, how they are going to plan it, and each day what they are going to do before they came to fulfill it? Bible says, let us create. So it wasn't one person. Idea, it is the axe. And then they said that day one, we will do this. Day two, we will do that. Day three, were they worried? No. But they have already planned. When you don't plan your life, you plan to fail. I pray over you now first. That God, not only in money, but you invest prayer. You invest fasting. You invest the studying of the word. You will invest it. There is a man, a great servant of the Lord in Nigeria now, who is a blind man, but he's a father. If he has not invested in the studying of the word, he wouldn't have continued to preach. So they sit him straight to the altar. When he wakes up, he knows the number of steps to take. And when he comes, he opens the Bible. But all the Bible is here. He preaches from his spirit. Invest. Invest. Each day, a chapter. Revise a verse. Each day, in a month, you have 30 verses you can quote offhand. Strategic investment. I want you to sit up and stop playing games with God. Wish and never plan. It will never come to you. The Lord said to me to tell you that four brothers have surrendered and I saw you among them. He says, I'm making you a voice to deliver them. And I saw a sister that stood and said, brother, I need help. And the Lord said to me, I did not save you and brought you this far for your sake. He said to me to tell you, I brought you this far for your family. He says your salvation is attached to the salvation of that family. And the Lord God is telling me, you have been praying for one particular brother for almost 7 years now. Am I communicating?
You're correct.
It's correct. And the Lord said, I have arrested his heart for Jesus. He will come to you and say, brother, I have given up of my old life because I want to serve Jesus. Tell your sister that marriage is not going to be a problem. He said, the days of disappointment are over. No man will break her heart never again. I have seen a crown over her. I have seen God honoring her. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that it is done. Dudu, the Lord will smile on you.
Thank you.
The Lord said to me to tell you that he has not forgotten you.
Thank you, Jesus.
And sometimes you feel very lonely and you see things happen in the life of people and you say, when, Lord? The Lord said to me, you are too close to your miracle and to your breakthrough that you have ever come from. The Lord God is telling me to tell you, if you don't know, your bed was a covenant. And if you don't know, go and ask your mother. Your bed was a covenant. Your mother sought you out from God and God gave you to him. And God said he was going to use you among all the siblings to bring great joy to that woman. And sometimes they feel that you are the favorite because the way you are being treated is because of what the mother went through. It's what she went through to bring forth this woman. This woman is crowned with glory and honor. And I see the manifestation of it all over. Brother, can I take 2 minutes to pray for one more person and give the microphone? Thank you. Thank you. Jesus. Look at me. I want you to be careful with me. If there is anything that will destroy your future, is that when you don't act wise. When men are coming after you, it's not because you are beautiful. It's because they want to destroy your future. And I want you to be careful. In the realm of the spirit, God opened my eyes and behold, I look and I saw blood
coming out of this young lady. And I asked the Lord, what is this? And the Lord said, this is an abortion that they want to commit through her. That she will go in and do a wrong thing, commit an abortion, and after that, this womb will be destroyed. And the Lord said to me, let her be warned. If there's anything in the past, don't repeat it in the present. Let her be warned. I called somebody, Joyce. There is only one lady that I called that came on that day, but the other time I saw, I need only that one. D-A-N.
Dan. Name Dan. D-A-N. Your name is Dan. Where are you? Dan. D-A-N.
Oh, Joyce, you are here. Thank God that you are here. Joyce, I've not finished with her, so wake her up. Not for her to sleep. In the month of July, I was doing a meeting for Assemblies of God, one of the big branch in Ghana. And the Lord walked me to a young lady. And I said, young lady, be careful. Because I see you getting pregnant, so be careful. 3 weeks ago, the pastor called me and said, do you remember that young lady you told her to be careful because you see her pregnant? I said, I don't remember anybody because when I come to a church, I don't keep people in my mind. It's okay. You remember you said that? I said, I don't remember. If I said it, remind me. Say, yeah, you told this young girl to be careful and you warned her. You kept saying it, that I was so embarrassed. I didn't know why you are doing that. He says, that girl have gone to be pregnant with a Jehovah Witness guy. So when we say things to you, we are not joking here. Because we don't need to excite you with anything. Young girl, God is having mercy on you one more time. The mistakes of the past will not repeat itself. The mistakes of the past will not repeat itself. Father, save her from destruction. Save her from the destruction of men.
Yes.
Save her. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Joyce, I saw you standing and I saw two men standing and they were pulling you. You were in the middle and one was holding your right hand, the other was holding your left hand, and they were all pulling you. They were pulling you to the extent that you were so confused where to turn to. And suddenly I saw you saying, Michael, I heard you mention a guy's name. And you said, Michael. And when you said that, you began to cry. And the Lord said, warn her about a Michael guy who is coming to frustrate her life. Young lady, if you are in an ungodly relationship, I will ask you, come out to restart your life. Juanita, remember I told you that I saw you standing at the age of what? You remember what I said?
No.
You don't remember?
No.
Okay, I saw you entering to the age of 16 and I saw you hit up to the age of 23. I remember I said something like that. 23, 21, and I saw plus 2 and it got to 23. Okay? And when it got to 23, I stopped and I said, I will tell you what to do. Okay, now when you enter into 16 and you stand on it, there is a settlement.
But there's something I want to tell you and mommy alone, not for church. So come to mommy and let me talk to you. Where is Joshua? Joshua, come to me. Daddy's brother's oil on your life. You know I'm your dad's brother, and you don't know. When I got here, I said, are they brothers? They look alike. Or we don't look alike. Even if we don't look alike, our height alone speaks for us. Jacket. Run for it. Daddy.
Prophet mentioned someone, a man called Dan, D-A-N.
You are there and you are Dan. Come to me.
Hurry
I want
up
you to come to me. Listen to me, Joyce. Don't allow men to pull you. Stay in charge of your life. And I said, if you are in a wrong relationship, step out. You cannot keep yourself 2 years and still be waiting.
You have stop waited that for movement. Too long.
It is time. If the bus is not moving, jump out of the bus and look for a moving bus. Now some of you are sitting in wrong buses. That is why the bus is not moving. You have sat in it for years and you are still sitting in it. Jump out of it and get the right bus to sit in. I didn't say anything, but I've said something. Lord, you will not confuse her. Michael will not come into her life to destroy her because she cannot be pulled away from you. I place on you the mark of the Lord. It's amazing what I see. The glory that is upon her. And the Lord God is telling me that she's going to use this young lady to correct marriages, 40 marriages in that family. You know what I saw? I entered into their compound, and as I was approaching their compound, I saw 3 women sitting. And I said, who are these? And the Lord said, these are aunties whose marriages never worked.
Right.
And the Lord said to me, they give them children, they don't give them marriages. You are here and you are going through the same thing. Lift up your right hand. Let me pray for you.
Jesus.
Gladys. You have children, but you don't have husbands. And you see it repeating itself in the family. It is not only you who suffers it. Your auntie suffers it. Your big sisters have suffered it.
Yes.
Even your younger children, the younger sisters, are suffering it.
Yes.
Today, we stand in this auditorium and we say, let this curse be broken. Let this curse be broken
in
this family.
The
in the name
Jesus.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
We command marriages.
Yes.
That are sustainable.
Release.
We release them.
Release.
Upon you.
Release.
2013.
In the name of Jesus.
We will come for your marriage.
In the name of Jesus.
2013. We will celebrate your marriage.
In the name
2013.
Of
Jesus. There will be a lot of marriages.
Hey.
In this house.
Hey.
I prophesy.
Hey.
In the name.
Hey.
Of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
Joyce.
You are bringing joy to your family.
Joyce, you are bringing joy to your family.
I thank you, Lord, that it is done.
Yes. Itokobo Sanda. Eshtolama Tataka.
You know what they call mission director of a ministry? Mission director. Where daddy sit at home, Joshua go to America to supervise the work there and bring me reports. Go to South Africa, check what is happening to the church, and bring me the report. More of the apostolic order that is upon you. The Lord said to me, you will travel the nations of the earth. You go to the school and school. But you will come out of school with a ministry out of the school. Joshua, listen to me. The first day you enter to the campus, you will see two men walking towards you. Don't ignore those two guys. They're listening and listening very well. The moment you enter into that varsity, you will see two men walking together. Don't ignore them. Greet them, find out their name, and make sure you connect to them. This is what the Lord is saying to me to tell you. It's going to be like a revival that is taking place in the area of prayer. You begin to gather people and say, look, I want us to pray together. And by the time you realize it have caught fire around you, it have caught fire at a radius that everybody wants to be part of that prayer movement.
Yes.
And in that prayer session, you begin to speak into people's life. You begin to activate the prophetic grace that is on your papa. And the Lord said to me, don't be afraid of any face on earth. Don't be afraid of anything. And he says, say it as you hear it and see the manifestation come to pass. Hear me. You will begin an outreach that is going to hit universities' campuses. That there will be sessions of River of Life. This campus session, campus session, campus session. It's going to be amazing. Man of God, you have thought of it, but the coming to pass have just begun. The campus's ministry, he is going to spearhead it. That mystery that brings revelations to the voice that speaks. The prophetic
out. Are you asking for Dan? Okay.
Where?
I've sent, understand he had gone out.
Okay.
Where is he?
Jordan.
He's at church.
Put that thing down.
Is he the one?
River of Life will sing their own songs that Jordan is going to write them. Jordan, listen to me. The Lord said to me, anytime you go into the shower to shower, you begin to sing out. And the Lord said to me that He is going to open your ears. You will hear songs from heaven. And He says you will write them down. And He says some of them you may not even sing it, but they will be singing your songs all over. In the front seat, was sitting in a wheelchair, stood up and began to dance without anybody praying for the woman, out of the worship and the praise. This is how God is going to use him. He might not be preaching the way Joshua will be preaching the word, but he will lift songs that lift people out of bondage. Have you written a song before?
Yes, I have.
You have a song? Well, clap your hands, girl, for Jesus. Don't stop writing. Don't. You're going to write songs that we will sing forever. How many of you know that Sinash for Pastor Chris? All the songs they sing in Christ Embassy is Sinashi's songs. And this was a very well-to-do woman doing extremely well. And said, God said to her, she should resign what she is doing and follow the man of God. And just create songs that build the atmosphere for the servant of the Lord. And now her music is all over. So shall it be with you. Your music will be heard all over. Where is that? I want to pray for Dan and then I'm done. Oh, my good friend. A very good woman. Very good woman. The Lord said to me to tell you that the pain you came out from, you are not entering into it again. There are some things that a woman is not able to share. Only few she can pour her heart to. And she walks very lovely around, but it is her alone who knows what is going deep within her. But the Lord said to me, tell her that the pain that she came out from, she is never going back into it. Ruth, you will never be disappointed in life. Amen. Never again in your Amen. Life. Service has reward. Therefore, you will not serve the man of God in vain. You are laughing and laughing again and again. I see a crown on your head. I saw her smiling again. And the Lord said, tell her, she will smile again and again and again and again and again. Thank you. Stand here so that I can close. Wherever he is, can you?
And apparently he left and he's gone. Understand there's a group that went to Jubilee. Am I right?
Okay, let me say this. You can convey this message to Dan. That the Lord said to me to tell Dan that he is going to restore back the dignity of men in that family. I walked and behold, I looked into their family and I saw men stood at the age of 47 and they behave like children. And I said, what is this? And the Lord said, the covenant that was made in the past is still alive speaking against men. And the Lord said, I will use Dan to change that error. So tell Dan that I said that he is restoring back the dignity of men in that family. Men are becoming men again. How many of you know that there are men that are like boys?
Yes.
They are in the family, they are boys.
Yes.
Even they are children.
Yes.
But the order is changing.
Yes.
Everyone under the sound of my voice who is suffering this, I command a change in the name of Jesus. Thank God.
Lift up your two hands for the restoration of your house.
Jesus.
For the miracles you are walking in.
Yes.
For the healings that have taken place.
Thank you, Jesus.
For the breakthroughs you are embracing.
Thank you, Jesus.
For the doors that have been opened.
Yes, receive it, receive it, receive it.
Thank God.
Receive it tonight.
There is a higher place God is
in the name of Jesus.
Oh.
In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
For you are great.
Jesus.
You do miracles
of grace.
There's no one else. I wish I could touch everybody in this place. There is no one
like you.
Ta-ta.
For
you are great.
Wherever you are, receive it, receive it.
Join your hands together.
You are great.
You do miracles. The Bible school student.
There is no one else.
cha 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 cha
do
cha 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 cha
do
cha 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 c